This is the tightest schedule that we've ever run at Java Dev. We wouldn't have chosen to do it this way, but we had so many good talks. And let me tell you, we had to reject about half of the talks that we were offered, some of which were excellent proposals. So if you are in the audience and you were rejected, I'm very, very sorry. It's not... doesn't cast any slight on the quality of the proposal at all. In the end, we just had to cut it down to what we could manage. Because of that, there won't be very much time for questions at the end of the talks. I would like to encourage speakers to use as much time as they can. Maybe it's okay to answer and ask one or two questions if there is some spare time. Otherwise, I very strongly encourage speakers to make themselves available at the end of their talks to people. So you can take questions outside and spend as long as you like discussing your favourite subject with people who are interested. But we have to run to time. I think that's basically it. I will now introduce... Sorry, what? You can speak. This is a message about our sponsors, who Mario remembers, I'm sure. Certainly we are very grateful to IBM and Oracle. And SAP. Without much further ado, I'd say I would introduce Mark Reinhold, but probably lots of you have seen him before. He's been the legal engineer of the... at this point, I'm just going to step aside.
Thank you, Andrew. Good morning. Can people hear me?
Yes.
Microphone. Okay. All right. Good. So this has now become a bit of a tradition after all these many years. The state of open JDK, and it's the state of open JDK in two senses. One is the state of the community, and the other is the state of the technology. So I'm trying to intermix the two. I know that some of you are here not because you like to work on open JDK. Job, that's great. So there's stuff here for everyone. So our community continues to thrive and grow. This is a good thing. We had 7 new projects approved this year. I'll talk about most of these later on. The Duke project, for those of you who don't know, is going to be a long-term home for all the Duke artwork. You may recall Sun open source Duke putting them under the BSD license back when eons ago. We have a bunch of new committers, 14 new committers voted in this year. 3 of them are not Oracle employees, those are the ones in orange. They work for our tool, Intel, or they're just independent. They show up and they do good work. We have 8 new reviewers. Reviewers are a higher level in our system than committers. They have the authority to approve changes going into the mainline code bases. There are 8 new ones this year. More than half don't work for Oracle. I take this as a good sign. This means that things are operating independently, and more non-Oracle contributors are moving up and getting responsibility. So we've also made some progress on improvements in how we all work together. In some cases, these are projects, efforts that have been underway for years. So the vulnerability group is something we've been trying to create for 3 years now. Unfortunately, as with anything that involves lawyers, it can take time. It can take an unpredictable amount of time, especially when it involves lawyers from multiple companies all having to agree on the same document. So there it is. Anyway, I, running in a matter of just a few more weeks, not months, and certainly not years. And this is all important now that we are firmly in the era of Spectre meltdown and probably an infinite stream of funding side channel attacks going forward. Another improvement is the compatibility and specification review group. This was actually created just after FOSDEM last year. So a little bit of history for those of you who don't know. Sun had this internal group called the CCC that dated way back to 1997, really interesting time, whose job was basically to do this: ensure consistency, ensure quality, ensure that the changes to APIs and specifications coming in were consistent, and so forth, and above all, compatible with everything. He continued to operate even during the OpenJDK, even after OpenJDK was created, which of course is a source of tension, because it's this internal thing that the external contributors would have to somehow find somebody to help them deal with, and that's because it's not only not acceptable, it's not efficient. So we created a compatibility and specification review group in OpenJDK. As I said, was approved in February last year, right after FOSDEM. These are members off the census. It includes one non-Oracle member, Doug Lee, who knows a thing or two about API design. But that's good. Everything that the group does, all the proposals for specification and API changes that the group reviews are in the bug system. So if you're bored, you can go follow along and even comment on things. Have insights to contribute to incoming changes. So it's all public, it's all there for everyone to see. Okay. Sure. I'll play school with you, but there are a bunch of seats down here in the front. Yeah, and also if people could, we're going to do a back room. There's no reference counting here. Just move. Hotspot and don't have access to all machines. There's a people do a good set of tests across all the different platforms. So last year, this was experimental. In the meantime, our Oracle's internal built-in test system has changed from the old system called JPRT, which you may have heard of, to this new system called Mach 5, which you may have heard of. And so it was offline over the summer, and we had to rejigger a bunch of the back-end stuff. But anyway, it's back now, and it runs on Mach 5. We're still ironing out a few bugs. I don't know if Alexi got his email back.
No.
You never find out what happened at Com? No, sorry. Well, Tim will track it now. He's very diligent. Anyway, so it's no longer experimental. That's good. And if you want more information, you can find it on this wiki page. Please note that there's no throttling on this. So if you wanted to, you could go push a gazillion change sets in here. But don't do that. We're trying to trust people, not set up variables. All right, another place where there's room for improvement. So this is a tricky topic. I've chatted with a few people about this. It's my sense that we've gotten to the point in the OpenJDK community where we need to get a little bit more formal about who maintains what. Right? There's obviously a bunch of code that everybody cares a lot about. If Jotlang string broke, that's what you do. Yeah. But there's also code that some people care a whole lot about, and other people, they're happy that it's there, but maybe aren't gonna maintain it themselves, don't have the expertise, or don't have the hardware. So I've spent some time looking at how other communities handle this kind of problem, particularly the VCC community, and the Linux kernel, and the RubySD folks. There's not by no means standard, but common notion of having a maintainer spot on the root of your code tree that documents who is responsible for what, with some guidance as to, well, if you're going to go change something in this area, and you haven't been involved in it before, you should go talk to this first. So that's been one source of inspiration. But also, I think we can do this just by observing what we've been doing informally now for a while, right? There are ports in the repo that weren't there 10 years ago. In some cases, weren't there 5 years ago. PowerPC VIX ports, S390 port, the AR64 port. These are all important things, but not everybody has the hardware or the knowledge to maintain those as changes occur in the core of the system that inevitably do affect those ports. And so, the informal practice, the sort of obvious one that's thrown up is, well, changes will happen to the common code. If somebody's working on, say, a big refactoring in Hotspot, they'll make sure that people who are maintaining all of the ports are aware of the changes coming in. But someone changing, doing a refactoring in Hotspot is not obligated to go test every port. They might not even have the hardware able to do that. So these other ports are maintained primarily by their maintainers. And if a refactor comes into Hotspot, then the maintainers need to keep up with that. So this is just an initial notion, and I'd love to get feedback on this. Today, as we're chatting informally, I'm still not quite sure how to write all this down. I've taken a couple stabs at it, and the documents just wound up too long. I wasn't too sure. So here's a slide. The ultimate shortness. Let's see if I can condense it down. So, three tiers. 1, 2, 3. That's pretty simple. A tier one feature or component or subsystem, I'm not quite sure what to call it, is something that's critical to the ongoing success of Java. It can be built and tested on commonly available hardware and operating systems. And if a build of one of these platforms breaks, or a build of one of these features breaks, then that's a P1 bug. It's hair on fire, got fixed right away, and whoever made that change is their responsibility. Tier two is something that's important to some, maybe a whole lot of contributors, but not everyone. It might require special hardware, your operating systems, in order to test. Build breakage of this kind of feature is a P2 bug, so it's important. Got to fix it soon, but you don't need to stay up all night. So, and fixing it is primarily the responsibility of the maintainer of the feature rather than the person who Then tier three is a feature that's a candidate, or actually has been deprecated as a candidate for removal. This is what happens when a feature has no active maintainers, or if its maintainers have decided, okay, it's just time for this thing to go. Breakage of a tier three feature is a P3 bug. It'd be good to fix it. It's not a showstopper to release if it's not. So these are really just some initial thoughts. As I said, I dealt with feedback and advice on this because it's been difficult to figure out how to write it all down in a way that doesn't get overly formal. All right. Another improvement. Now, to be honest, I'm not sure if this is an improvement. I'm not sure that everyone will like it. I'm a little bit queasy about it myself. All the cool kids these days. Oracle is actually a really big Slack customer. We've got Slack spaces at Oracle coming out of our ears, channels everywhere. And I have to admit, having used it for the last year and some, it's useful. I mean, it's like it's IRC with a better user interface. Although I still miss the terseness and let's say the low latency of our IRC as opposed to large files of JavaScript running the browser. Anyway, so the Slack is around. It's really popular. A bunch of people find it productive. Should we get one?
No.
any yeses?
Is it open source?
Any yeses who don't work for Oracle? Is it open source? No, it's not. And that's part of that. I'm queasy about that, too. Is it a commercial operation that could disappear in 3 months if they don't get funding? Yep, it is. Where's all your data? So opencata.slack.com actually exists. I kind of created it like 3 years ago. Before Slack was a thing. Thinking, well, maybe Slack could have done something. Maybe something we would want to use. I'm the only user. It's really long. If we wanted to, we could make sure it has all the right IP stuff around it and open it up, and it could be used by contributors and others. But if the sense is that nobody would use it, then we won't bother. Should we bother? Yes? No? No? Andrew is cleverly just I don't know. Like I said, I'm with you about it. Would it be an improvement?
Well, as long as it's past IRC gateway.
It does.
Yeah.
Does that clean your nose?
Yeah.
There is an officially supported IRC gateway.
That changes it.
Does that change anybody's vote?
Yeah.
Okay. So how many people say we should do it now? Yeah. Okay, well, thanks for all your fair input. All right. Enough about that. What have we actually been working on? Well, the big thing that we've actually been working on, of course, finally, shipped Go9, JK9, last September. This was a big release. We finally delivered Jigsaw. We finally delivered the modular platform. Big change. We delivered about 100 other smaller features. Well, actually, some of them were kind of large. They just weren't as large as Jigsaw. So thank you to everybody who helped with this release. It was certainly controversial at times. I think its adoption rate might actually be a little higher than we expect. I know that the download statistics on Oracle JDK, somewhat surprisingly, are almost as high as they were for JDK 8. We're not sure why, but we're glad. So apparently a lot of people are kicking the tires. So if they're kicking the tires, what is next? Well, we hopefully what's next is a bunch of adoption of JDK 9 by the whole many people have never, if you haven't contributed, if you did contribute to it, you don't get the research. How many people have tried 59.9? How many people will use it in production?
Okay.
One or two. Why is that? Well, I understand there could be some trepidation because you may have heard that GABA 9 breaks everything. Check that again. Well, that's not true. GABA 9 breaks some things. Not almost everything, but breaks some things. Usually things that are, getting their fingers into internal APIs and doing all kinds of other nasty stuff. We know it breaks some things. We try to walk a careful line of moving the platform forward while not breaking too much old stuff, but some old stuff, sorry, it just needs to be taken off. It just needs to be repaired and evolved to prepare for the future. We did take compatibility, especially around the specified part of the platform, the Java SE platform, as understood by the JCP. Seriously, that's one reason why all of this took so long. So I won't go into all the details here, but a lot of things do actually work on Java 9. You don't have to take my word for it. Shortly after 9 was released, I asked on Twitter, do you maintain a popular Java library, framework, or tool? If it works fine on JDK 9, then please reply with its name and version. And I got a big pile of responses. Here's a summary. It's not exhaustive, but it has a lot of popular things on it. All of these things work fine on JDK 9. They either work without change, or in some cases, their maintainers have to make a few modest changes. On this list, you will find the major IDEs, Eclipse and IntelliJ, the major build tools, and Gradle, test framework, JUnit, and TestNG, libraries, ByteBuddy, Jackson, Log4j, Hibernate, Juke, Netty, the entire Spring framework. So a whole bunch of stuff is here. If you're trying to run something on 9, one of the first things you should do is make sure you upgraded all of your dependencies so that you have all of this new stuff that's been fixed. All right, so it's time to adopt 9. But what comes after that? To understand more about the future, let's take a brief look at the past. For 20 years now, more than 20 years, Java has evolved in large, irregular, and somewhat unpredictable steps. Each release has had one or a few really big features in it, and the release has been held until those features are ready, adjusting the schedule as needed, sometimes more than once, which gets really painful. That's good for big features, but it's not so good for smaller features, because it means a smaller feature that's done, well, it turns out 2 years before the release ships, was unavailable for the people wanting to use it for 2 years. So we wound up with releases that are grand and majestic, but rather slow moving. For Java to be competitive in this day and age, it not only has to move forward, it has to move forward faster. So that's why we're switching to a strict train model of releases. A new feature release every 6 months on a time-based schedule goes out in 6 months, highly predictable. Let's try to visualize this. Here's a timeline. We just shipped Java 9, September 2017. With a new feature release every 6 months, the next release will be in March of 2018. Ooh, that's just a few weeks away. Wow. Release after that will be in September of 2018, and then we'll do March of 2019, and so on and so forth. March, September, there's a pattern here. Keep that going. Every feature release can contain any kind of feature, including a feature that removes an old feature. Features go in only when they're ready, only when they're nearly finished. There's going to be none of this, oh, this thing's two-thirds done, we want to put it in to get some feedback, and we'll just slip the release a couple of times until we're sure it's finished. No. The beauty of the 6-month model is if you miss the current release, that's okay. Because because there's another release just 6 months away. And I have to say, you know, being almost done with the next one, should be in March, it's really a breath of fresh air when you realize, oh, this thing I've been working on, I wasn't quite ready. Oh, I can just push it in the midline in a couple more months, and it'll be the next one. That's great. So in terms of how about the lifetimes of these releases, the notion is that the readers of JK and together will support each one of these feature releases for at least 3 months, or at least 6 months. Right, at least 6 months with 3 months for quarterly updates. So at least two, but no, at least. That doesn't mean at best. Very different from at most. A 6 month release is fine if you're a leading edge developer, you know, deploying something in the cloud, and your own image maybe, and you update it whenever you need to. It's not so good for enterprises who are used to more traditional app server type deployment, you know, big job installations on big hardware, who really don't want to upgrade very often. So what we plan to do is have a long-term support release every 3 years. So the release in September 2018 will be an LTS, and the release in September 2021 will be an LTS. And if this graph were a little bigger, it would show that JDK 8, the new 9, it would be like way out here. JDK 8 is with the previous long-term support release. Don't we need some overlap? Excellent question. I'll refer you to a couple of slides. All right. Now, there's a problem with what to call these. 9 obviously is called 9. When I made this proposal last summer, I suggested the naming scheme to say that this did not go over well. There was a lot of feedback, much of it emotional, but some of it was quite rational. I thank you if you sent it rational, clear feedback. If you sent it emotional feedback, I pretty much heard it. Anyway, we're not moving on. What we will do is the more sensible way, which is almost completely compatible with the new version scheme that we already introduced in 9, which is just called a... Now, it did require some, you know, modest tweaks to the version scheme that we introduced in 9, but we're probably not going to break too much. All right. So that's the plan for what goes on in OpenJDK. Contributions from everybody. Those of us who work at Oracle are making changes also. So the next slide, when I say we, I mean those of us who work at Go. So amongst the changes, we are shipping GPL license to OpenJDK in addition to the binary code license commercial Oracle JDK builds. These are already available for 9 and for the 10 early access releases at jdk.java.net. So we are open sourcing all of the Oracle closed commercial features. I'm glad you're thrilled, and I'm thrilled too, because maintaining closed code that I don't have to be open code is an incredible cost on Oracle engineering staff. Amongst the things, well, the primary things are AppCDS, the application class data sharing, which you will hear about later today, Java Flight Recorder, Java Mission Control, and the Zag Garbage Collector. AppCDS is in JDK 10. As you see, we open sourced it a few months ago, back in the fall. JFR and JMC are works in progress. Another change, Oracle engineers will focus primarily on Linux, macOS, and Windows, on x64, and still spend relatively less effort on other ports. finally, we're going to dedicate some staff to working with other OPA contributors to figure out how to do a real open build test system that anybody can use. It's one of the last long-term things that we've all wanted to do for OPA today. And just wanted to try to staff that up, see if we can make it go. Now, as with any enormous change, I know there are lots of worries and some confusion. So let me try to address those in my best Dave Letterman style, the top five misconceptions about this release model. Number one, non-LTS releases are experimental. It's just a fancy name for a beta. Wrong. The only difference is that LTS releases have a longer support timeline. You should not fall into the trap of thinking, oh, if my feature doesn't make it into this LTS, nobody's going to use it. Or I should plan this feature so that it's going to be in this LTS, or I can't deprecate it until the next day LTS. No. LTS, it's not even something that's necessarily uniform. You know, one implementer, one vendor could decide to do an LTS on every single feature release if they want to. Maybe there's a business in that. I don't know. Number two, every feature release will be as disruptive as past feature releases. No. What's constant is the rate of innovation. The rate of innovation, which correlates very strongly with the rate of disruption, doesn't change. The rate of innovation will increase rather than introducing changes once every 3 years on an unpredictable schedule. We introduce changes every 6 months on a more predictable schedule. Number three, to remove an old feature requires 3 years advance notice. No. To remove a deprecated feature, what it really requires is a production-ready build that issues a suitable warning. If possible for that warning, it usually is. Because a working build with a suitable warning is the ultimate release note. You can't ignore it. Well, you can ignore it after the first time you see it. You can't say, oh, it was in some obscure release note I didn't see. As to how much time should pass between deprecating a feature and actually removing it, it's a matter of judgment. In some cases, 6 months will be adequate. In some cases, a year will be better. For something really big, yeah, maybe 2 or 3 years is a good interval. Number four, if you maintain an infrequently migrated system, think big app server, then you can just ignore the non-LTS releases. That would actually be a bad idea. If you're maintaining a system like that, you can test with each feature release. Because if you do that, then you'll be almost ready for the next LTS when it comes out, rather than having to do a bunch of work that all piles up at the end. Number five, there will never be more than 2 updates for any non-LTS release. And there will never be more than 3 years of support for any LTS release. It all depends on who shows up. It all depends on where you're getting your builds from. Right? You might be paying some company for your builds. You might be doing them yourself. You might be building them on your own through Open JDK. Whatever. It depends on who shows up and how you're getting your code. Now, speaking of showing up, I know there is some concern about the extent to which Oracle will show up. To show up. So I'd like to put some firm lines around that. In terms of commitments, what Oracle tends to do, so this is another one of these slides where we mean those of Oracle. Oracle will lead and contribute to every JDK feature release. Oracle will lead and contribute to at least the first 2 quarterly updates of every JDK feature release. Oracle will publish OpenJDK builds under the GPL for at least the above releases, maybe more. Oracle will lead and contribute to the JDK updates project until at least January 2019. And we will do our best to ensure smooth leadership transitions, even when Oracle ever steps down roles. I know there's been a bit of a kerfuffle recently. We didn't do as well as we could have with the BDK9 updates. Sorry. But I think that part of that is just growing pains around getting onto the 6-month model. And we will make it work. But it's definitely Oracle's intent to ensure smooth transition so that other individuals, other organizations active in the OpenBDK community can step up and help share some of this burden. Now, note that the phrase at least occurs on the slide multiple times. Again, that means it's a lower bound, not an upper bound. If you look at the past in terms of how Oracle handles end-of-public updates to its commercial releases, often such commitments are later on extended if the situation warrants. All I can say is these are the lower bounds that we can guarantee today. Okay, I'll take my Oracle hat off when I OpenJDK back on. The intent is that in the OpenJDK community, there will be three years of support. Which contributors help make that happen is up to those who show up. If nobody shows up, then those LTS releases might not have 3 years of support. They might only have 6 months, they might have 12, I don't know. Oracle is not committing to do more than 6 months. That doesn't mean Oracle won't do more. I'm just saying what the commitment is. All right. So we've got this train model. We've got a release going out the door every 6 months. It's time-based. Time marches on. It, like the tide, it waits for no one. It just goes. To feed this model, we need a pipeline of features and products. And well, yes, guess what? We actually have such a pipeline in our devs. So JDK enhancement proposals, these are documents we've been using now for quite a few years, going back to JDK 7. Way to document proposals, get feedback on them, and ultimately follow something through the process of getting merged in mainline code. We've got quite a number of guests. There's a lot of it. Many of these were merged into 8. Some of them are still candidates. Some of them have been closed. A few have been withdrawn. But anyway, lots of guests here. My goodness, we're in the 300 now. Yeah. Oh, and the really fun part is the unsubmitted and draft gems at the bottom. This is where you can find, you can sometimes find stuff that seems out and came by accident that the author didn't know to be published. So there's cool stuff in here, including some stuff that's been withdrawn, and of course the very recent popular one, raw string literal, there's a bike shed for you. Anyway, steps are the pipeline that feed the train model. So as we think about going from 9 to 10, the question is not what features are planned for 10. No, we're not doing waterfall. No, I'm sorry, Mr. Executive Vice President. I can't predict what is going to be in that release 1 year from now. I can make a guess, but it's just going to be a guess. So the question is what features are ready for 10? Here are the features that are ready for 10. These are the features that are in 10. Guess what? We're weeks away from shipping, so there aren't going to be any more than this. It's just these 12. I won't go through them all. But there is definitely some cool stuff here, including my own modest contribution to that product. One thing I will dive into, just so I can say that I showed some code, is the first one, local variable type inputs. So it's a reasonably popular opinion that Java does not have type inputs, but in fact, Java hasn't had type inputs for many years. In Java 5, we introduced type inference along with generics so that you didn't have to type this annoying string thing when you were invoking collections or dot empty list. You could just type the obvious thing. We introduced some more type inference in 7 with this concept, the diamond construct, so you could emit the type when you're invoking the constructor. Lambda in 8 included a whole bunch of type inference so that you didn't have to laboriously type out the type of every parameter in the lambda expression. You could type the obvious thing and the compiler would go off and figure it out for you. Thank you, Maurizio. In 10, we have local new buffer reader that, blah, 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 what a pain in the butt. Why can't I just type bar? You know, all the other cool, really wacky languages do this by now, or was going to do. So let's just do this in Java. So this is what we have in 10. It, you know, the adding of local in the name of feature support, it is local. You can't use this on a field. You can't use this on a return type of a method. It's really just for, you know, small scope of code that you're in total control of, and where you can actually make your code more readable by just typing bar rather than repeating a bunch of long names. I'm sure your IDE could write that for you, but it's a little thing you have to read it. So here's a longer example where you're making a URL connection and a scanner around it, and that doesn't look nice. And no, don't worry, it's not JavaScript. It's not Foundry. So getting that schedule, as I said, we are weeks away, March 20th. For general availability, we are on the verge of building the first release candidate. That will be next Thursday. So keep your eyes on the bugs. Moving on. 11. What features are going to be, what features can you guarantee will be in 11? I have no idea. But here are those that have been targeted so far. In fact, the first one, dynamic class file constants, was merged, well, mostly merged a few days ago. There's a little, I think there's some stuff waiting for ARC to work, but that will get in. Dynamic class file constants is a cool feature. John Rose will be happy to tell you all about it. It basically does for class file constants what Dynamic did for methods. We have Alexis Epsilon garbage collector. We are finally going to get rid of and then we're going to clean up some local variable type of stuff. Okay, FineWork is on. There are a bunch of bigger projects feeding into even longer term pipelines. Some of these big projects have generated a few jobs already. Some of them are still quite nascent and just getting started, like reviews here. Results. And finally, certain amount of overlap. There are two DCs here that have overlapping requirement and solution spaces. But I'm looking forward to these teams working together over time. So we can pick out one DC that addresses all of those requirements. Okay, so we've got all of these projects. We've got a bunch of smaller things in the works. All of this is intended to help God moving forward faster. Don't do the word I have said.
Thank you.